warning Republican lawmakers against voting to release a classified memo, a memo written by Republicans alleging misconduct by the FBI in the Russia probe. Extraordinarily reckless. Well, just a short time ago, Republicans on the House Intelligence Committee ignored that warning and ignored a request by the director of the FBI to appear personally and explain why releasing the memo is not a good idea. They ignored that as well and voted along party lines to release the memo. Keeping them honest, they also voted not to release a memo written by Democrats, which Democrats say point out the falsehoods in the Republican memo. The top-ranking Democrat on the House Intelligence Committee spoke out a short time ago.
We had votes today to politicize the intelligence process, to prohibit the FBI and the Department of Justice from expressing their concerns to our committee and to the House, and to selectively release to the public only the majority's distorted memo without the full facts. A very sad day, I think, in the history of this committee. As I said to my committee colleagues during this hearing, sadly, we can fully expect that the President of the United States will not put the national interest over his own personal interest. But it is a sad day indeed when that is also true of our own committee, because today this committee voted to put the President's personal interest, perhaps their own political interest, above the national interest, in denying themselves even the ability to hear from the Department and the FBI. And that is, I think, a deeply regrettable state of affairs.
So, in the name of transparency, the Nunes memo will come out, only the Nunes memo. Democrats say this is clearly an attempt to derail the Russian investigation, delegitimize the law enforcement personnel taking part in it. I want to give you some context here. The Republican memo was written for the chairman of the committee, Devin Nunes, the same Devin Nunes who temporarily shrank from the spotlight months ago after he rushed the White House to brief the president on the allegedly shocking facts he had just allegedly uncovered about the Russian investigation. Facts we later found out he had just gotten from the White House, the very White House he claimed he had to rush to in order to brief them on facts they already had. Facts that were surprisingly similar to White House talking points. It amounted to a smokescreen as well as an attack on the intelligence and law enforcement communities. Democrats say that is what today's memo is really about as well, a smokescreen, an attack on the intelligence and law enforcement communities involved in the Russian investigation. And that brings us to tonight's other big breaking story. The number two man at the FBI, Deputy Director Andrew McCabe, is out. Now, you probably have heard his name before because the president has repeatedly singled him out for criticism. If you notice who the president criticizes in law enforcement these days, it does tend to be a certain kind of career public servant, the kind of public servant he targets the ones investigating him, his team, and his campaign for possible collusion with Russia and or possible obstruction of justice. Why did Andrew McCabe abruptly leave his job as deputy director of the FBI today? Well, our sources offer mixed accounts, with some describing it as a mutual decision and others saying he was forced out. McCabe, though just 49, had already announced plans to retire. He becomes eligible for full retirement benefits on the 18th of March and may have already had enough unused vacation days to leave now. So in some ways, although the precise timing apparently took official Washington by surprise, the fact that it happened was hardly a shock, given the president's vilification campaign against him, which makes what White House Press Secretary Sarah Sanders said at the briefing today so hard to believe.
Can you say definitively then that the president did not play a role in Andrew McCabe stepping down?
Yes, I didn't say the president wasn't part of this decision-making process.
If she means this decision-making process about leaving today, perhaps that's true. There's no evidence that the president ordered Andrew McCabe out today. But it's been abundantly clear what the president wanted and wanted him gone. It began last July, the president tweeting, "Problem is that the acting head of the FBI and the person in charge of the Hillary investigation, Andrew McCabe, got $700,000 from Hillary for wife." The president is talking about Mr. McCabe's wife, a Democrat who ran for Virginia's statewide office in 2015 with the financial support of then-Governor Terry McAuliffe's PAC, McAuliffe obviously an old Clinton friend. Now, this happened before her husband was involved in the Russia probe, but the president believes it influenced him to go easy on Hillary Clinton and presumably to be biased against the president. The FBI Inspector General is looking into it. Late today, in a staff email, Bureau Director Christopher Wray hinted that the Inspector General's upcoming report played a role in McCabe's departure. For now, though, the only thing out in the open is the president's antipathy to the man and open suspicion of him. There are the tweets, including one mentioning how many days until McCabe's benefits vest, which read like a veiled threat. There's the Washington Post report that days after firing FBI Director James Comey, the president met with McCabe at the White House and asked him who he voted for in the last election. The president denies doing that. The president has also taken aim publicly and in private at Deputy Attorney General Rod Rosenstein and has considered firing him as well. He's publicly attacked Special Counsel Mueller, of course, and actually ordered him fired, then backed down after White House Counsel Don McCann refused to do it. The president has loudly and publicly spoken out against his own attorney general for recusing himself from the Russia probe.
I am disappointed in the attorney general. He should not have recused himself almost immediately after he took office. And if he was going to recuse himself, he should have told me prior to taking office, and I would have quite simply picked somebody else.
Bear in mind, the attorney general is one of the president's original supporters, and it goes without saying he's a Republican, as are Andrew McCabe, Rod Rosenstein, and Robert Mueller, as is Jim Comey, the FBI director he fired, as is Christopher Wray, the replacement he himself picked, as are a large number of FBI special agents and top brass at an agency he's described as being, quote, in tatters.
Well, it's a shame what's happened with the FBI, but we're going to rebuild the FBI. It'll be bigger and better than ever. But it is very sad when you look at those documents, and how they've done that is really, really disgraceful. And you have a lot of very angry people that are seeing it.
Now, bear in mind, the president isn't slamming the Interior Department here. He's not publicly attacking, say, a deputy undersecretary of state or assistant energy secretary. He's not accusing staffers at the USDA of political bias. The president of the United States is attacking the public servants, even cabinet members who have roles, have had roles, or by the president's way of thinking, should have bigger and friendlier roles in the various investigations of Donald J. Trump. Very much, always. Here to discuss tonight's eruption on Capitol Hill between Republicans and Democrats over the memo, a very distinguished group, CNN's Gloria Borger, former Republican Congressman Jack Kingston, and Bakari Sellers. Gloria, what's happening with this committee?
Well, I think it's kind of stunning. I think it's sort of devolved into partisan wrangling. And I think you have a president right now who is taking on his own Department of Justice, including the FBI. I spoke with a friend of the president's today who said to me, and maybe you can confirm this, said that the president believes that his FBI is corrupt, period, flat out, that's it. And I think what you saw going on today was Devin Nunes and many of the people on that committee were basically saying the same thing. And that even though the head of the FBI said, please don't do this right now, can I come up and talk to you? They said they want it released. And my next question is, what does Chris Wray, who runs the FBI, do next?
Well, that's what Congressman Kingsman, that's what's so interesting. You know, we had a congressman on the committee who was saying, well, Chris Wray looked at it and didn't have any changes, but everyone else that we've talked to, including former Chairman Rogers, says that's not how it works. Of course, Chris Wray's not going to take out a pen and start making changes. He wants his own people to review it. Is it appropriate to release this kind of information without having the Department of Justice, without having the FBI actually review it?
Well, they've had an opportunity to review it, and they've had an opportunity to help supply this information.
Well, but they say they haven't. They said it's extremely reckless. The Department of Justice wrote a letter saying it's extremely reckless. That was their term.
I can't react to that letter because I just heard about it tonight. But I do know, talking to members, that it's been available to members of Congress. 200 members of Congress have read this. And it's interesting that if there's anybody who's let it become a partisan issue, it's the Democrats, because they should have been there reading the memo and saying, look, this is not right. But I can say
this. Well, they did. They wrote their own memo pointing out what is inaccurate.
But they did not read it. They did not come out with this is what's wrong with it.
They did. That's what's in their memo.
I'm talking about rank and file members could have done that. I think that the Democrats on the committee felt like there was a line in the sand. But
let me say this. But factually, what you're saying doesn't make you just said they didn't point out inaccuracies. But they did point out inaccuracies, and now you're saying, well, was it rank and file people?
The general group, the Democrat members, the rank and file members, have had the opportunity to read the memo and come back and push back about it, and they haven't done that.
And the Intelligence Committee, of course.
And I think it's going to be an interesting debate because, you know, we haven't read the memo yet.
Right.
When we read the memo and when we have an opportunity to say, okay, are the Democrats right or are the Republicans right?
Wait a minute. You're just doing double talk. What you're saying makes no actual logical sense. We won't know what the Democrats say because the Democrats who did write a memo, despite you saying that the rank and file didn't push back.
Once this memo is released in public, then I'd say the topic's on the table for people to say, this is wrong and here's why. So I think the Democrat memo in its formal context.
I really don't want to jump in because Representative Kingston, Congressman Kingston, is actually showing why this is nothing more than a partisan football and the conundrum that the Republican Party is in.
Not that the Dems have ever been partisan in this.
But I do believe that what we're starting to see is, one, we're seeing Chairman Nunes completely in over his head. But even more disappointingly, the person who does not show any courage or valor during this moment when he needs to stand up is Paul Ryan. I mean, the fact of the matter is, if Richard Nixon was president and Paul Ryan was the Speaker of the House, then he probably would nominate Richard Nixon for a Nobel Peace Prize. He has done absolutely nothing to stand up for the foundation and the tenets of our democracy. The big news today, though, and you spoke about it just briefly to Senator Lankford, is the fact that the President of the United States will not implement sanctions on Russia, who we know is a bad actor. That is the news of the day. And with all due respect to Senator Lankford, if we're waiting on a response to why the president chose not to take this act tomorrow in the State of the Union address, then that is just wishful thinking. I am so distraught, not as a Democrat, not as a South Carolinian, but as just an American today, because the Republican Party has let the tenets of our democracy just fall at the wayside. And right now, people are saying that Donald Trump is above the rule of law, and that simply is not the case. And if somebody wants to stand up and fight back and fight for what our democracy means, then so be it. But Republicans right now are just cowards.
You just look at how this occurred, though. You see the president who's been griping about Andrew McCabe. He's been tweeting about him for months. Then you see that Jeff Sessions, the attorney general, says to Chris Wray, the head of the FBI, get rid of this guy. Chris Wray doesn't want to do it. He goes to the White House counsel, Don McGahn, and says, please don't make me do it. And now, suddenly, he's gone.
I got to jump in.
We were getting warmed up.
I need to respond to one of them.
Very quickly.
Let me just say, James Rubicki, the chief of staff, was the first one to say McCabe had a conflict of interest. And if you think you can read those Peter Strzok, Lisa Page emails and say there's not a problem of prejudice here, then you know that absolutely there's some.
Thank you, everybody on the panel. Chris Cuomo is going to pick up the coverage with Cuomo Primetime right after a quick break.